Hello everyone, greetings to everyone who joined our first webinar on August 2nd. Welcome back. And everyone joining us for the first time today, thank you for attending what is a very interesting and unique series of webinars on product durability and fatigue testing. In the first webinar, the focus was on an introduction to durability testing. And in the same vein, today, we're going to look at road load data acquisition. I must at this stage remind everyone that this webinar series has been curated in a manner that makes it important for all of you to participate in all the webinars in order to get a comprehensive understanding of the subject. While today is the second part of this webinar series, our next three webinars are lined up for August 6th, 10th, and 12th. So do remember to join in for the remaining of the webinars as well. The Siemens Durability Test webinar series brought to you by Mobility Outlook will see knowledge being shared by two experts from Siemens. Our expert today is Mr. Gert Franz. He is the Business Development Manager, Data Analytics and Durability at Siemens Digital Industries Software based in Leuven, Belgium. His areas of expertise include mobile data acquisition systems for the automotive and transportation industry, from optical measurement systems to inline robotic laser scanning and load data processing for durability testing. Gert holds a Bachelor's of Science in Industrial Sciences from Groep T. Leuven at Belgium. Gert will be the lead speaker for today's webinar as well as the upcoming two webinars. Our other speaker today is Mr. Kumar Swami S. Kumar is Director, Testing Solutions and Engineering Consulting at Siemens Digital Industries Software, India. A mechanical engineer with postgraduate degree in automotive engineering from Coventry University, Kumar has over 18 years of working experience in applied noise, vibration, and durability engineering domain within sales, support, and engineering services organization. Currently, Kumar heads portfolio development and pre-sale operations for SimCenter Testing Solutions and engineering consulting services at Siemens Digital Industries Software, India. He is an active member of the Acoustic Society of India, Society of Automotive Engineers, Condition Monitoring Society of India, and an associate member of the Institution of Engineers, India. So before I invite Kumar for his introductory remarks, I must remind all of you to participate in this session actively by asking questions to our experts. Please remember to post your questions only in the Q&A panel provided at the bottom of your screens to ensure we do not miss out on your questions. We should also be posting the recorded videos of this series on our website soon. Do take a look at mobilityoutlook.com. Thank you once again for joining our webinar today. And now it's over to you, Kumar.
Thank you so much, Deepanshu. I'll just share my screen. Just let me know if you can see this screen.
Yes, Kumar, it's visible now. You may proceed.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Again, a very good afternoon to everyone for joining us for the second session on the durability testing masterclass. And a very good morning to my colleagues from Belgium, Gert, and we also have Ralph from Germany, who will be speaking on the last session of this series. So, the format of this series, we call this as a masterclass. The intent is to go deep dive in the topic that we have selected, and we have done also a few in the past. And for the current series, what we have selected is the durability testing. As strength and durability is one of the most important quality parameter, both from safety and also the customer experience point of view. And there, again, very important element is to accurately collect the loads or the road loads, what we call, and represent how the customer is using these products, right? So that's the intent. So we had an introduction session on Monday, which was the beginning of this seminar or the masterclass. And today we will go a deep dive on road load data acquisition. And again, just to remember, make you remember again, the Deepanshu already mentioned this. We have three more sessions coming up on Friday, Tuesday, and Thursday next week. So please do mark your calendars and make time to follow this as well. So in the first session, what we discussed was about the approach of what we call hybrid durability engineering and how we can make the best of both test and simulation world and how we combine and kind of complement each other. Then there was some slides on durability. What is durability? What is fatigue and so on and so forth. Some of the elements of test-based load determination, which kind of try to represent the customer usage of the product usage part. And we started already with some elements of road load data acquisition by talking about some of the quantities that we measure and also typical sensors that are used in durability test campaigns. Today, the session will be on road load data acquisition. So we will go deep dive into the instrumentation part. Again, to take us through this topic, we have Geert Frans from our Leuven office in Belgium. And I welcome him. And also, I wish you a great session today as well. So as Deepanshu said, please do share your questions on the Q&A panel. And we'll try answering at the end of the session. And for some which we can't answer, we'll park it and we will also share a response directly to you on the later day. Yeah, thank you so much. I wish you a great session again, and get over to you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Kumar, for the introduction. Let me share my screen. I think you need to unshare your screen, Kumar.
Yep, did it. Get.
Yeah. Okay, share my screen. Good. Let me start the presentation. Do you see the title slides?
Yes, good. Yes.
Yeah, perfect. So, namaste and good afternoon also from my side. Welcome to the second session on our durability testing webinar series. As indicated by Kumar already, so today we will I will mainly talk about the data acquisition part of a typical durability test campaign. So this is, if you remember, for those of you who participated or joined the session on Monday, this is a slide where I explained the typical activities of a durability test campaign. Without going into much detail, it starts with the test preparation, where the simulation engineer creates a list of all locations on his simulation model for which he would like to get real-life load inputs. This list goes to the technician, who will, based on the list, instrument the vehicle with different type of sensors. Then afterwards, the test engineer will set up his measurement equipment. When the vehicle is ready, he will go to the proving ground, and a professional driver will drive with the vehicle over different durability tracks. Ideally, still on the proving ground, the test engineer will validate if the driver followed the predefined test procedures. And then when all this is done, the test engineer can go back to the office, where a more in-depth data consolidation and analysis will happen with the data. In most cases, also a report needs to be made, and maybe the data needs to be changed or converted in order to share with other teams. And in many cases, also a test schedule can be created for simulation, test benches, and proving grounds. So the session of the day will focus on those four steps here. So instrumentation, test setup, measure, and validate. Good. Let's start with the first activity. That's the instrumentation activity. So in the session on Monday, I explained a little bit on the typical sensors that were and quantities that were measured for a durability test campaign. So today I will focus more on the data acquisition side. So what are the typical challenges when using this type of acquisition systems, and how these challenges can be handled by the SimCenter product portfolio. Good. So for all of the different activities, I will briefly explain what are the typical challenges for that activity. And then I will give you an explanation on how our customers overcome these challenges. So a first challenge is to acquire, to measure and synchronize a very wide range of different types of sensors. As explained on Monday, something typical for durability testing is to measure a wide range of different type of sensor types. We talk about measuring strain gauges, displacement sensors, accelerometers, load cells, vehicle canvas data, thermocouples, wheel force transducers, location, and in some cases also video cameras. Now, what we see when we look at other systems on the market, then we see that a lot of them offer a dedicated module or box or device in order to measure those different type of signal conditions. Yeah? So in the end, the customer ends up with a group of different type of modules, units, and so on inside the vehicle, which all require space in the vehicle. They all require power, and they can all break in the end. Yeah. Now, if you look at our SimCenter product portfolio that we offer for durability testing, then actually we have two different hardware. We first of all have the SimCenter Scalas Recorder, and we have the SimCenter Scalas RS. And depending on the customer application or his specific needs, we offer one of both. Yeah? And there is a big overlap between them. But in a nutshell, the SimCenter Scalas Recorder is a system that typically is used in case the customer would like to do a combined durability and NVH testing, or just NVH testing. Where we offer the Scalas RS in case the customer would like to do load data acquisition for durability in very extreme environmental conditions. And in the next coming slides, I will explain in more detail the exact differences between those two systems. Let me first start with explaining it a little bit more on the SAS Scalas Recorder. So concerning the architecture, the Scalas, as you can see, the Scalas Recorder consists out of a single system frame in which you have always, or by default, a system controller module. So that's the module with which you can connect to your PC, which gathers all the data from the different modules and potentially link to other devices. Yeah? And this single frame then can further be filled with so-called signal conditioning modules. Good. This Scalas Recorder, so actually the system frame consists in different or comes in different sizes. So first of all, we have the so-called Scalas Recorder 09. So besides the system module, which is in the upper right corner, you can fill this frame with nine more modules, signal conditioning modules. And as you can see, each of those modules can measure up to 8 channels. So 9 times 8, this means that with this Scalas Recorder, you can measure up to 72 channels. We have one size smaller, which is the Scalas Recorder 05. Same explanation, so 5 modules, 5 times 8. So with this frame, you can measure 40 channels. We have even a size smaller, which is Scalas Recorder 02. So with this, you can measure up to 16 channels. But I've put it in let's say, light gray, because as explained on the session on Monday, durability testing is typically measuring a lot of channels, 70 plus channels. So this is a size that we do not frequently sell to our customers. So the main recorder that we sell is the 09 or the 05. Now, for those customers who for which 72 channels is not enough, you can simply connect multiple recorder frames with each other, as you can see on the right, in a so-called main secondary setup. So in this case, you simply connect two frames to each other with an optical cable. So that's the orange cable you see here on the right. And for the acquisition software, this is very transparent. So for the acquisition software, it is as if it's one big system of 2 times 72 channels. So 144 channels. Good. So I've been talking about measuring a wide range of different type of signal conditioning. So what we offer to our customers is a universal signal conditioning module. And actually we offer we can offer 3 different type of modules. We have, as you can see, the DB8-3C module, the one at the bottom, the DB8-3 and the VB8-3RT. Yeah? What is common for all these modules is that they cover a wide range or can cover a wide range of different signal conditions. So that goes from strain gauges in all formats, so half bridge, quarter bridge, full bridge, accelerometers, displacement sensors, load cells, voltage, current, and also active sensors. So with that, the customer has a complete sensor connection flexibility, where with competitive systems, the customer needs to think, okay, this cable is coming from a strain gauge, so I need to plug it in that dedicated signal, strain gauge module. This cable is coming from an accelerometer, so I need to plug it in the dedicated accelerometer module. Now here, you can just plug all sensors into the same module, so no channels will be lost. And also, thanks to this universal signal conditioning module, he can standardize his measurement equipment. Yeah? So when he buys one of those three modules, actually, he doesn't need any other modules to measure at the analog channels. So I hear you thinking, what is then the difference between those three modules? That's actually the sampling rate and the bandwidth. Yeah? So the bottom one, the DBA3C, can sample up to 51.2 kilohertz. The bandwidth up to 5 kilohertz. The DBA3 is one level higher, can measure up to 102.4 kilohertz, same bandwidth. And then the super duper module that we have is the VBA3 module, which can measure up to 204.8 kilohertz and even a bandwidth up to 92 kilohertz. Yeah. So due to these differences in sampling rate and bandwidth, the bottom module, the DBA3C, is actually our main core durability module, main core universal durability module. So with this, you can do road load data acquisition, experimental stress analysis, measure forces, strain, displacement, accelerations, accelerometers, and so on. With the DBA3 module, the one in the middle, besides doing durability measurements, you can also do so-called multi-attribute measurements. Due to the little higher sampling rate, you can also do strain-based model analysis, strain-based TPA, vibration control, and ground vibration testing. And then with the VBA3, with this high sampling rate and high bandwidth, you can also do NVH, besides the durability and the multi-attribute testing. So road noise TPA, strain pattern analysis, experimental stress testing on engines and so on. So thanks to this rather high sampling rate and bandwidth, this enables our customers to do hybrid durability NVH testing with the same single hardware platform. Yeah? So the customer does not need to switch to another measurement system or measurement module in order to do durability or NVH. Good. On top of the universal signal conditioning modules that you can embed in the SCADAS recorder frame, it also has, and that's included in the system module, which comes by default, you have a removable storage. So that are compact flashcards, which can storage data up to 256 gigabytes. It also has by default a GPS receiver. So with the SCADAS recorder, you can also measure the location of of your vehicle. It has a campus port and also two TACO inputs. And in case of mobile data acquisition, the system can also optionally be equipped with a battery pack, which allows autonomous operation for up to 2.5 hours. So depending on the number of channels and also depending on the type of sensor that you measure, this can go up to 2.5 hours. So thanks to the removable storage and also the extra, let's say, conditioning of the SCADAS recorder, this system is really designed for standalone recording and doing multi-physics testing. A little poll, which I would like to launch, because I'm interested in how you do your durability testing. How do you work in your team, in your company? So the question is, does your team for which you work, do you do both durability testing and NVH testing? And the questions or the answer is very simple, yes. And I do that with the same hardware. So I use the same hardware for both durability and NVH testing. Yes, but I use a separate hardware. So I have a dedicated data acquisition system for my durability test and a dedicated hardware for my NVH testing, or no, my team does either only durability testing or only NVH testing. So I'll give you a couple of seconds to answer. Yeah, so that's actually what I expected. So indeed, we see that still a lot of customers use a separate hardware to do either durability or NVH. Yeah. Good, thank you. Next slide. Good. Let me now give you a little bit more details on the SimCenter SCADA RS hardware. So the architecture is actually different from the SCADA recorder. So as you can see, this system can consist out of different signal conditioning units. On top of that, you have a data recording unit, and these units are all daisy chained together with a cable. So thanks to this very modular and scalable architecture, this system can be used to really optimize your setup for either small but also large test campaigns. And we'll come back to that later. Let's go a little bit more into the signal conditioning units. So first of all, as explained, one of the challenges is measuring a wide range of different signal conditioning. To cover that, we have a dedicated universal signal conditioning unit, which is called the U12. And with this unit, you can measure more or less the same type of sensors that can be measured with the DB8-3 modules, which I showed you from the SCADA recorder. One extra that you have even over here is the analog tacho, which you don't have on the DB8-3 or VB8-3 modules. Good. So thanks to this wide range of different signal conditioning, also here our customers has a flexibility concerning how to connect your sensors to the units, and he can also standardize his measurement equipment. Now we have two other signal conditioning modules, which as you can see contain 24 channels per unit, so not 12 as with the U12 unit, but we have 24 channels per unit, and we have two different units over here. So we have the B24 units, which we cover mainly the bridge signal conditioning. So this is quarter bridge, half bridge, full bridge, the piezo resistive sensors, and also some of the RTD sensors. And also on top of that, some other signal conditioning like potentiometers, inductive sensors, and also differential voltage inputs. The S24, you can already guess, so S stands for sensors. So this unit supports all different type of sensor signal conditioning, like ICP sensors, generic voltage inputs, sensors with external supply, and also current loop sensors. So thanks to this very high number of channels per unit, these units are really ideal for doing large test campaigns. As explained during the session on Monday, durability testing, there you measure typically 70, 80, 100, 150 channels. So in order to limit the total volume or size of your data acquisition system, this system is really ideal to cover that challenge. Good. So beside the signal conditioning units, we also have the REC unit, which is our standalone recording data unit. So also this unit has onboard storage, but in this case, it's not removable. And I'll come back to that later on why it's not removable. The onboard storage can save data up to 240 gigabytes. So it's an SSD memory. It has a GNSS receiver. And GNSS means that it does not only is capable of measuring the GPS signals from the American satellites, but also the GLONASS, so the Russian satellites, and also the Beidou, so the Chinese satellites. So it's a little bit more extended as the SCADA recorder. It has an input to measure four digital IOs. It has four CAN-bus inputs, so that's three more than the SCADA recorder. So these CAN-bus you can use to measure either the vehicle CAN-bus. Some cases you also can use it to measure thermocouples, wheel force transducers, and many more. It has two USB inputs, which potentially can be used to measure web cameras. It has three inputs connectors to measure encoder inputs or 3 times 3 pulses, so 9 pulses in total. And the 4 connectors at the bottom right can be used to also, in the near future, measure the digital interface of the Kistler wheel force transducers. Good, so thanks to this onboard storage and extra conditioning, besides the dedicated signal conditioning modules, also this system is really designed to do standalone recoding and to do multiphysics testing. Good, to come back to the statement that this system is really or ideal to optimize your setup for small or large test campaigns. So imagine a customer has a set of 2 rec units. It has, and I'll come back to this units, it's a UPS or power supply units, 4 power supply units, 1 universal U12 unit, and a set of B24 units and S24 units. In that case, the customer can really select from this pool of hardware to fit the test campaign of the day. So for example, he can create a very small system setup for 12 channels, as you can see on the slide, or he can combine the different units to create a setup for a very large measurement campaign, in this case 384 channels, or he can even create 2 parallel systems which he can use to measure 2 times 192 channels. So he can really maximize the usage of his existing hardware thanks to these scalable and flexible setups. Some examples. So here you see a setup of the SCADA ZS, where in the back you have 6 units and at the front another 3 units. So in total, with this setup, you can measure 120 analog channels, and on top also GPS channels, COM channels, digital IOs, and a couple of more. Good. So that was a first challenge. A second challenge that we see, and that this is mainly in case of doing a measurement on large vehicles, is the cable instrumentation. Yeah? Again, if durability testing is about measuring 70, 90, 150, or even more sensors, all these sensors need to be connected with the cable to the data acquisition system. So this takes a lot of time to instrument. It takes a lot of effort. And also a lot of cost, because cables, they cost, as you all know, they cost a lot of money. So how do we handle that? So for that challenge, actually the SCADAS RS is the most ideal system to handle that challenge. Let me explain a little bit more in detail. So you can have actually 2 different types of setups. So a first setup is what we call a centralized setup. So in that case, you have your acquisition system located somewhere central in or on your vehicle. So here we have a set of units which are stacked together. I come back to that later on, how you can do that. And in case you would like to measure 60 sensors, then this means that you also need to instrument the vehicle with 60 long cables. So from the location of the sensors, which are distributed over the vehicle, you need to also put and fix a cable through the central data acquisition system. That is a setup that we see with a lot of customers, and in many cases that is okay, but it has some disadvantages. So as you can understand, this can lead to a high cable cost. You have long cables, a lot of cables. These cables add extra weight to the vehicle. Depending on the size of the vehicle, this can have an influence. Takes quite some time to fix all these cables. The cables need to be fixed very securely to avoid they come loose during the actual measurement. In case some of those cables break during the measurement in the field, it's not always straightforward to replace that cable, let alone to find the right cable in that bunch of cables. And long cables are also very sensitive to electrical interferences, especially when that cable passes an electrical component or electrical engine. This cable will pick up noises, voltage drops, and other phenomena. So how can we solve all these challenges is by creating a so-called distributed setup. thanks to the system architecture of the SCADA ZRS, you can actually bring the signal conditioning units close or closer to the actual location of the sensors, as you can see here on the picture. So in this case, instead of having 60 long cables, you only have 60 short cables. So in that case, you can shorten the length of the cable, you can reduce the cost of the cable and also the instrumentation time, and you will also minimize the voltage drops, magnetic interferences, noise pickup, and other negative interferences. So this will, first of all, simplify your hardware installation and also in the field repair. So here now you only need to replace one short cable. It enables a quick and parallel instrumentation. So what we see with some of our customers is that they ship, for example, one part of their vehicle, maybe the suspension or the front loader, to a subcontractor, which instruments that specific component or subsystem with the different sensors. So then the customer can ship together one or more signal conditioning units, and the subcontractor immediately can also immediately connect the cables to your data acquisition module. And also you can deliver noise-free, high-quality data thanks to the shorter analog cables and the long digital cable. So that's the yellow one that you see on the picture. Couple of pictures. So here you see a big construction machine, a front loader, where we have a distributed setup of the SCADA ZRS. So here at the back of the vehicle, we have two units, which in this case, the yellow cables, this goes to a one signal conditioning unit that I think it's a U12, which is mounted in the middle. So that goes to the sensors that are located in the middle of the vehicle. And then we have, that's maybe hard to see, two signal conditions close to the front bucket of this machine. Another quick poll. So after I've explained the difference between a centralized and distributed setup, which setup would you, in your specific situation or application, which would you prefer? So yeah, there is the poll. So the two answers that you can select is either centralized or distributed. Of course, this will depend, and that's something I cannot see when you answer it. This depends very much on the type of vehicle that you measure. If you measure smaller vehicles, then I can imagine that the centralized is good enough. But in case of bigger vehicles, I suppose the distributed will be more beneficial. Yeah, it's more or less 50-50, let's say, which I expected. As I explained, it depends on the type of vehicle. But it also clearly indicates that there is a need in some cases to do a distributed setup. So to distribute your measurement modules over the different locations of your vehicle. Good. Give a little bit more detail on how our system is designed to avoid or to overcome these, let's say, cable mess that you can have in some cases. The way that the different units are connected together is with one single daisy chain cable, that through which not only the data stream is going, but also the power. If we look at competitive systems on the market, then we see that most of them, they have two separate cables. So one cable, which is between two modules for the data stream, and one dedicated cable for the power. So here, that's not needed. So only have one cable for both data and power. Yeah, the length of this cable can be up to 50 meters, but I'll come back to that later on. There is no adapter cables or units needed. Also here we see with competitive systems that to guarantee this universal signal conditioning, they have a dedicated unit. And on top of that, you need to plug in an extra adapter cable or little box, adapter box, in order to be able to measure that different type of signals. And also all cables can be plugged into the front of the system. Also here, some systems there, you also need to plug cables in the back. But this then would make it more difficult for the system to be mounted on the vehicle, because you need to keep the back of the system also free. So this limits you in the way that you mount your system on in or on the vehicle. Good. So advantage is that you can simplify the cable instrumentation. Good. With that, I would stop sharing my or I'll stop the presentation. I will give a short demo of the Scalas RS hardware. I will stop sharing, and then I should give me a couple of seconds. I will start my video again. I have in the back in my house, I have a Scalas RS system on the table. Yeah, and I hope you can all see this clearly.
Yes, good. This is visible.
Yes. Okay, good. I will step to the back and I'll explain a little bit. So first of all, you see here a set of four units. So the top one is a power supply unit, and I'll come back to that later on in the presentation. The one in the, down there is the REC unit, so that's the data recording unit. Then the next one is an S24 unit, so with the 24 channels. And the one at the bottom is the B24 unit. As you can see, these units are stacked together. Yeah. So they are mounted together. So they are as one big system connected together. And the way that they are connected together is with a so-called slide and latch mechanism. So in order to detach that, and it's difficult to show on the video, there is a small button here at my thumb on the right side. So when I push that in and I slide the module or unit to me, lift it and slide it away from me, then actually you will see that I have, I'll put it a little bit more to the back. So you can put this unit to another location. Yeah. So in that way, I can create very simply a distributed setup of this data acquisition system. So the way to mount it back, simply slide it on and it clicks tightly. Yeah. On the back, let me detach again. So on the back, you have, and they're now covered with rubber caps, but if you remove them, you have mounting holes. So we have four mounting holes, so screw holes actually, which you can use to mount the all the units onto a structure or onto the vehicle. Yeah, and that's one option. Yeah, the second option, which is a little bit more convenient, is the so-called slide side clamps. And I will take the camera and put it a little bit closer. So here, my cable is not long enough. So here you see I have so-called slide side clamps, which you can use, put the camera back, which you can use to fix the system with tie wraps, with this. So I can put that tie wrap over here and then fix the system onto the rest of the vehicle. Yeah. Good. As you can see, the different units are connected together via the daisy chain cable. So these are these short cables that you can see between every two units. So these are these cables. By the way, do you see my screen enlarged? Eh? Correct?
Yes, good.
I am sorry. Just want to make sure that you see everything. Good. So the length of this cable is the shortest one that we have. That's 40 centimeters, but they come in different lengths. It's 1 meter, 5, 10, and even 50 meters. So 5, 5, 0. So you can really put your units far away. So this is ideal, for example, for trains and other large vehicles. The REC units you see here, what else do you see over here? You see, first of all, a GPS antenna. So the system comes with a GPS antenna to measure the location of the vehicle. It has two antennas over here. So these are Wi-Fi antennas. I will give more details on the next slides, but you can use this to wirelessly connect to the measurements. Of course, you can also connect via a LAN cable to your PC. So that's the connector which you see over here. There is also a USB connection, because we know that a lot of PCs, laptops these days do not have a laptop connection anymore. Good. And that's what I wanted to show on the Scala ZRS at this up till this moment. Good. Let me put my camera back and then launch the presentation, share my screen. Launch presentation. Okay, do you see my screen again?
Yes.
Yeah, perfect. Good. So we have our data acquisition system. I've explained a little bit how you can use it, how you can set it up. So the next step is to define the sensor and measurement parameters in the acquisition software. And there, a challenge is that actually, if we look at a lot of our customers, they still do it in a manual way. So channel per channel, they go through the list, and typically they have a data sheet of each sensor with all the different parameters, like the sensitivity, which voltage that you need to supply, and so on. And these parameters are then entered manually one by one into the acquisition software. As you can imagine, this takes, especially for large test campaigns, that takes quite some time and is also very sensitive to the errors. If you type in these numbers, it's very easy that you can make a typing error. Good. So with the SimCenter TestLab Neo software, allows you to do a fast and error-free channel setup. Yeah? Also, this software allows you to do a manual setup, so channel per channel, but also let's say, semi-automatic setup, either by automatically import the channel lists, or look up all the different parameters from a database, or read so-called TETs. So TETs are little chips that sometimes comes with the sensor, and on that chip is written all the different sensor parameters. So thanks to this fast and error-free channel setup, with one button click, you can upload your sensor information into the acquisition software. Good. I will show you a little video of how you can do that. The next demos I will do live, but this I would like to show in a small video. So here you see the list of all the different channels. Yeah? And as said, you can go channel by channel and then define one by one the parameters of that specific sensor. It's a potentiometer, displacement, and so on. But there is another way. So here you see a column called sensor ID. And when I open that, you have a drop-down box with some numbers in it. So these numbers come back into an Excel file. So we see, and I will stop a little bit the animation here, that a lot of customers, they have some kind of Excel database or Microsoft Access database, which is maintained and which contains a list of all the sensors that they have in-house. So they have a dedicated person who maintains that list, also calibrates different sensors, and then fills out those new parameters into that Excel. So as you can see over here, you have a lot of parameters that can be filled out. And also here you have this column called sensor ID. And this is what we call a lookup parameter. This can be any parameter. It only needs to contain unique values. And by linking this database to the TestLab Neo software, you can straight from the acquisition software select that specific sensor ID, push the lookup button, and then the software for you automatically will import all the dedicated sensor parameters into the acquisition software. Yeah? As you can see over here. So when I click accept, in some cases you also calculate some extra parameters based on the parameters that he has imported. So those are the yellow ones. Click accept and you're done actually. Yeah? So this allows the test engineer to with one button click to import all the sensor parameters. So it does not need to call to the dedicated engineer who maintains all the different sensors that can be used and ask for the, let's say, the latest update, the latest parameters, and so on. No, with one button click, he can import the database or the parameters into the acquisition software. Good. Next challenge when it comes to the test setup. Especially when doing mobile data acquisition in the field, then actually one of the challenges that a lot of customers have is to access the acquisition system in the field in order to check the status of all sensors. When we see at a lot of customers, they still need a PC with the Windows operating system on it. They need to have the acquisition software pre-installed on it. They need to have the correct licenses to run that software. They need to have a physical cable to connect the PC or the laptop to the acquisition system. Also, only one person at the same time can connect to the acquisition system, and a couple of more challenges. Good. A quick poll again. Again, I'm very interested in to know in what are your challenges. So next poll, is it also a challenge for you to access the acquisition system in the field in order to check the status of the setup? Yeah. Simple answers, yes or no. And this is maybe a little bit subject because I know that, yeah, if once you're used to a specific data acquisition system, even if it's not so convenient, after a while you get used to it. So it's maybe a little bit subjective answer that you have. A couple more seconds to answer. Yeah. So we see the majority of the people have answered yes. So indeed, it is a challenge to access the system in the field. Good. Thank you very much for your answer. Very, very interesting. Good. Let's go. Let me explain you for the two hardware how we handle that challenge. So first of all, with the Scalas recall. So for the Scalas recorder, we optionally offer a tablet, which is an Android tablet, on which we have installed a app, which is called the SimCenter Test Lab Control App, which allows the customer to wirelessly access the Scalas recorder to do the test setup, so to define the parameters, to do the actual measurement, and also to validate the measurement that you've done in the field. So in the little video on the right, you see that you can check your sensors during and also immediately after the measurement system. Now, I'm not going to go into the detail because what we see here with the Scalas recorder is also something that we can do with the option that you offer with the Scalas RS and even more. Yeah. Good. So thanks to this Android tablet and the Test Lab Control app, the customer can validate instantly in the field the signal and also test procedure quality. And also, and I will show you that in the demo in a couple of minutes, it offers a technician-friendly or user-friendly user experience, which require minimal training for the user to operate. Good. How is this done with the Scalas RS? With the Scalas RS, we even go a step further. So with the Scalas RS, we offer what we call a flexible system access. So what does it mean? First of all, you can access the system with any device. So you can use either a laptop or PC, a tablet, or even your own smartphone. This device can have any operating system running on it. So as I explained with the Scalas recorder, it's an Android tablet. Here with the Scalas RS, this device can have Windows installed on it, Android, or even iOS from Apple. You can connect to the acquisition system either in a wired way, so by using a LAN cable or USB cable, or in a wireless way. So you can connect via Wi-Fi or even 4G or 5G. And last and certainly not least, even more than one person at the same time can connect to the system. So thanks to this flexible system access, there is actually no need for the user to use a dedicated PC or device with the correct software installed on it. And it also enables you to do a fast and parallel setup. To give a couple of examples. So here on the picture on the left, you see an engineer who is using his own smartphone to access wirelessly via Wi-Fi to the data acquisition system, which you can see here in the back of the vehicle. Here on the right, you have two engineers, or let's say a driver in the front and a test engineer in the back. The driver or the person in the front is using his tablet to access or to connect wirelessly to the acquisition system. And at the same time, the engineer in the back is using his PC. He has a larger screen to also see which data is coming in from the data acquisition system. Another example from the heavy equipment this time. So here, typically, there the challenge is, as you can see in the cabin of such a vehicle, there is not a lot of space. You have one driver and then actually the cabin is already filled. So if you then also need to have an engineer beside the driver, this is not always very comfortable. So what you see over here is that you have your data acquisition in the back, so the recorder unit. And actually here, the test engineer is standing outside of the vehicle, next to the vehicle, using a tablet and connected wirelessly via Wi-Fi to the data acquisition system. So this makes it a little bit more comfortable. Here again, two engineers, one on the right using his tablet connected to this signal conditioning module, and the other engineer on the left or in the front, let's say, is connected with his smartphone to the two signal conditioning units mounted in the front of the vehicle. Good, so once you're connected to the SCALIS RS hardware, this is the screenshot that you will see. So this is the app that you will see. It's the SCALIS RS recorder app. This is a license-free software, which is pre-installed on the hardware. So if you buy the SCALIS RS hardware, the SCALIS RIC unit, the app is pre-installed and is license-free. Yeah. This app can be used to do the setup and the verification of the setup. It can be used to calibrate your sensors, and it also can be used to measure your data and also validate the data on the spot in the field, still in the vehicle. So thanks to this license-free software, there is no extra software or license or even installation needed anymore to use your data acquisition system in the field. Good, I will give a short demo afterwards, but to give you a heads up. So the app enables you to do an automatic sensor and channel check thanks to the condensed status overview, and also gives you or calculates online statistics and also gives you warning and alarm levels. So thanks to these checks, you can or a bad signal quality will be highlighted during or right after the measurement. And also gives you a clear and instant data visualization. And again, I will give you a short demo afterwards. It offers you, for example, this visual level display. And also you can create your own displays on the spot. So thanks to this instant and clear data visualization, you can have insights with one button click. Again, I will give you a short demo afterwards, and you can validate your data on the spot. Good. I will do a short demo. I will stop sharing my screen, stop the presentation, and then start the video, but to make it a little bit more visible, I will close my curtains and put the camera again. So in the back, you have the SCALIS RS system. And again, it's not so easy to use. So first of all, I have connected to the, let me try to position the camera. Yeah, okay. So to the two signal condition units, I have connected four sensors. So at the to the S24 unit, I've connected an ICP accelerometer. I hope you can see this. Then I've connected to the B24 unit, and this maybe now looks strange to you, but actually below this white part, I have a strain gauge. This device we use to test, amongst other things, to test the system So with this, I can make an, a quarter bridge, half bridge, full bridge, and so on. So now it's set to a quarter bridge. So this is connected. I have a wire displacement sensor. I hope you can see this. So this is an, a wire which comes out and enables me to measure the displacement. And I have another displacement sensor, which is an LVDT. So this also can measure displacement. Good. So I have a tablet over here, and we'll move it a little bit closer. So in this case, it's an Android tablet. Good. Yeah, it's disconnected. After a while, it disconnects. So I've connected wirelessly via Wi-Fi to the SCADAS RS. I put in the IP address of the system, so it's already connected, I see. Yep, loading, connected. I come to the, I come to the main screen over here. So we have a couple of buttons which you can use to, for example, show a list of all the different channels. So here, I hope it's clear to see. So I have a list of the channels of the REC unit, which is the GPS signals. I have my digital pulse signals. Then I have here my S24 module, where I've activated the first channel, which is my ICP accelerometer. And then the next one is my B24, where I've activated my quarter bridge. I've put my string potentiometer, my wire displacement sensor, and my LVDT. Yeah. Sorry for that. If you click on one of the channels, if you click on that, you have here on the right all the different parameters which you can change. So besides the fact that you can do your setup and do your setup with the Tesla Neo software, once you are in the field, you can still further optimize or change one of the parameters if needed. Yeah. One nice view that we also created is a so-called single channel view. And for that, it's better, I think, to rotate the screen. So this is a single view. So in case, imagine you have a sensor which shows some strange values. So with one single view, you can have a very visual representation of the current signal. This is, let's see, yeah, this is my strain gauge. I have some statistics over here. I have my actual time series. So this is the quarter bridge, which I'm now touching. And at the bottom, I have a frequency display. Yeah. Go back to the list, like that. Then I can use this to monitor my channels. I have different views. I have my status view. So this gives you an overview, a very condensed overview of all the channels. So if there is a channel which has a error, this is marked in with red, and also an icon on that specific channel. Yeah? And if I click the bell here on the right, I can have more information on that specific error. That's my status. I have a digital view. Where it's just numerical values. I can make it a little bit larger if needed. Strip view, so this is the time series. So when I move my ICP Excel, you see that the time series is moving. Then I have here my string potentiometer. That's the second one in the row. The visual displays is, first of all, the level display, and I already kind of showed it with the single channel setup. So this is my ICP Excel. So it's a very visual representation of the status of my channel. So the black triangle you see moving left and right is the current value. The light or highlighted green part is the current measured range with the min and max at the bottom. And then you have the yellow and the red part at the front and the back, which are my alarms. So if I exaggerate, you see that the yellow and the red part are highlighted. So you know that he has exceeded specific values. Okay, let's see. Ah, yeah, then the custom display to finish with. So here I have my, sorry, let me first delete it, then you see how it works. Yeah, so I can choose which channel I would like to display. I have a line display from my first channel. I can have a numerical display, and I have, for example, my wire display, sorry, my needle dialog, which you see over here, and this is my string pot. So if I move that one, you see how it is. Good. So I'm now connected with this tablet wirelessly to this data acquisition system. So let me go back to the strip view. So I'm now gonna use my own personal smartphone, which you see over here. Let me unlock it. I start Google Chrome. I type in the same IP address. It's already pre-selected. So it's now connecting to the system, connected. I've already selected the same view. So when I now move my ICP accelerometer, you see that actually in parallel, I can access the system at the same time. Good. That was the demo on the SCALES-RS app. Let me put the camera back there. Stop the video and share my screen again. Right. You see my screen? Can you please confirm?
Yes, good.
Yeah, perfect. Good. Measure. Yeah. How do we measure loads in the most extreme test conditions? So a challenge that we also see, and again, this depends from customer to customer, application to application, but we see that typically for durability testing that the vehicle is tested in very extreme environmental conditions. But this then also means that your data acquisition system needs to be rugged enough to withstand those extreme testing conditions. Before I continue, a new poll. So could you please answer, where do you mount your data acquisition system during the actual measurement on a proving ground or public road? And there are a couple of answers. So on the passenger seat or back row seat, in the trunk of the vehicle, inside the cabin, in case of a heavy equipment vehicle, outside on the vehicle, can be on top of the cabin, or as you saw in the pictures, near to the front loader, or other location. Give you a couple of seconds to answer. Okay. So most people either on the passenger or back row seat, yeah, and also inside the cabin. So if I understand correctly, it's most people put the system inside the vehicle. There are a couple of who put it outside the vehicle. So in case of those people who put the system outside on the vehicle, or maybe the reason why most of the people put the system inside the vehicle is because the system is not rugged enough. So for that, for those cases, let's say, the SCALES-RS system is really suited to do your data acquisition measurement. Yeah. So the SCALES-RS is very ultra rugged and extra protected. So first of all, it has a very high water and dust protection. So it has an IP rating of 66 and 67. So basically means that the system is dust tight. It can be cleaned with a high pressure power water jet machine. And it can even be immersed underwater up to 1 meter for half an hour without water going in. When it comes to ruggedness, you also talk about shock and vibration. So all of our hardware is being tested according to military standards. And the outcome of this test is that actually the SCADA ZRS is a vibration resistance of 10G RMS and a shock resistance of 100G peak. And also it can be used in a very wide operating temperature range. And here I'm talking about the environmental temperature. So not the temperature inside the system, but the temperature in which the system is put. So here the system can work in a range of minus 40 of up to 65 degrees Celsius. And the U12 unit can even work in up to 85 degrees Celsius. So thanks to this ultra ruggedness and extra protection, you can really avoid that your system becomes unavailable due to failure in these conditions, or even that it's unavailable due to repair. Some pictures. A couple of years ago, we did a measurement campaign in Germany on a proving ground with an electric vehicle. So that's the vehicle which you see over here. We call it the Simrod. So electric vehicle. We have been using the SCADA ZRS on that. And as you can see, it was during winter. It was freezing, so minus or below zero. And actually, at that moment that the picture was taken, I was the driver. Here you see the SCADA ZRS mounted on the front loader of a heavy equipment machine. So you see there is a lot of sand and mud on the system. So that's totally no problem for the SCADA ZRS. In the past, I've received a question on the open connectors. So here you see there is a connector which is open. So the connectors itself, they have the same or even a higher IP rating as the data acquisition itself. So even when you have water and dust and sand particles inside that connector, it will not break. We do, however, advise our customers to put protective caps on the connectors. Why is that? Because out of experience, I know that if there are sand particles inside the connector, even though you can clean the inside of the connector with by putting water on top of it, there are always still some sand particles left inside. So if you then would plug in a connector, you feel some friction. So that's why we advise the customers to use protective caps. Good. Now, when you talk about ruggedness and availability of your system, actually, you also need to talk about power supply. And that's something that many customers underestimate. You do not want to have your system shut down unwantedly during an actual measurement because the external power is cut off. So for that reason, we have designed a dedicated uninterruptible power supply unit, which is called the UPS unit, which is here on the picture. So this UPS unit, and that's also the one that you saw during the live demo, has an integrated power and health management, a little bit more extensive than the SCADA recorder, which makes sure that it delivers stable power supply and buffer to all the units and also all the sensors. It can deliver, so one unit can deliver power to up to four units. So as you can see here on the drawing on the right, so if you have connected to your REC unit four signal conditioning units, you only need to add one UPS unit on top of the REC unit. If you want to measure more signal conditioning units, as you can see here on the right, you just need to add one extra UPS unit per four units. The UPS unit itself can get its power from an external power supply. So that can be a vehicle battery or from a wall socket. But it can also get its power from so-called hot swappable battery units. At this moment, we don't have it, but there are on the roadmap. So those are extra battery units, which you can click on top of the UPS, and which will deliver power to all the different units and sensors for several hours. Also, the UPS is equipped with a remote on-off connector. So this enables the customer to automatically start up the units from the moment that the vehicle is started. Yeah. So thanks to this uninterruptible, smart and secure power supply, you can avoid that your test gets interrupted or even suspended. It will make sure that the system is shut down safely in case of a power cut and prevent that your data gets lost or even corrupted. And thanks to the smart powering, you can it enables unmanned autonomous operation. Good. So you have measured your data. The data is there. So now how do you check if the data is good enough to be further processed? No? So a first challenge that we see is that you have your data on your data acquisition system, but in some way you need to get that data to the, let's say, data validation software or data validation tool. Yeah? So to share that data from the field to the office with other teams for further validation and processing can be quite challenging. Yeah? The solution that we offer enables what we call automated data uploading and processing. So imagine you have a vehicle which is driven by a driver on a proving ground or public road, and you have your data acquisition system in the back. So thanks to the smart powering and also intelligent automatic triggering, actually there is no need for the driver anymore to operate the data acquisition system. It just does the maneuvers with the vehicle, and the acquisition system itself automatically starts, stops the different measurements. Thanks to the wireless capabilities of the SCADA hardware, the data can be automatically uploaded to a cloud or server, from which the data can be further shared with other teams, and in some cases even be automatically processed in the cloud or server. So this enables for test engineers, maybe one engineer who is in the office, another engineer is on the proving ground using his tablet, who can remotely view the data that are actually are measured on the proving ground. And also in case the data is automatically processed, the engineer in the office and on the proving ground, but also actually the driver who is sitting in the vehicle, can immediately check the processing results after the run. Good. Next challenge. I think it's the not the last one, but the four last one. As explained many times, something typical for durability testing is to measure a wide range of different type of chances. So for the test engineers to compare this large number of channels in a quick and efficient way can be very cumbersome. For that, I would like to give you a small demo with the SimCenter TestLab Neo software, where I will show you how TestLab Neo can instantly visualize the data that you select in your table. So I will stop the presentation. I will start the TestLab Neo software. Can you quickly confirm that you see the TestLab Neo interface? Kumar?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, good. So I've done a couple of measurements in the past, a couple of runs on the Belgian blocks, a couple of runs on the Sawtooth, and some miscellaneous runs. Good, now to visualize data, I select my run, and then I see here a table here on the left, which is called my pivot table, and this lists up all the channels that were measured during this run. Now to visualize data, if you look at competitive software, how does it work? They typically need to say to the software, give me an XY diagram, X is time, Y is strain, for example, then you drag and drop your channel inside and then you have your channel, your visualization. But if you want to visualize other channels, you need to repeat that over and over again. So here it works a little bit differently. So here on the right, you see a preview display and you see once I select a channel in the table here on the left, automatically the software shows me the correct graphic. No? This is not a let's say ordinary table. It has some extra functionality inside. So I can start combining, for example. So when I hold the control keyboard button, I can visualize a set of different channels. So all the channels in the Z direction. Automatically on the right, the preview picture shows me the four graphs. I can also, or I would like to see the statistics, I simply select them in the table and on the right, I have my visualization. Imagine I would like to group all the parameters according to their quantity. So how do I do that? I simply add a column. In this case, it's called y-axis quantity. And I add this as my first column. So here you see that the table has grouped all the accelerometers together, all the displacement sensors, all the force sensors, and so on. Yeah. Imagine I would like to see only those sensors mounted on the spindle. How do I do that? I simply add a filter called spindle, like that. So now you see that he has grouped all accelerometers which are mounted on the spindle. So when I select those six, I can simply scroll through the different data. I can overlap all of them and so on. I just see a number one in each cell. Why is that? It's because I've only selected one measurement drum on the left. To compare channels for different drums, I simply select one level higher in my tree view here on the left, like that. And now you see I have nine runs. Yeah? Nine runs here on total. So this is, for that specific channel, the nine runs. If I only would like to see the runs from the Belgian block, I add a generic filter according to the run name. And then I say only the Belgian run on the Belgian blocks. Yeah, I had this in the past. I'm typing now, but for some reason it doesn't select it. So I will do it like that. Good. So now you see that here on the right, he only shows me the four runs on the Belgian blocks. And if needed, I can save this view and use it for later usage. Good. Let's go back to the presentation. A last challenge that I would like to highlight is to how, as a test engineer, how do I validate that the driver, for example, followed the predefined test procedures? How, for example, do I check if the driver drove at a specific speed over the Belgian block and sawtooth track? Yeah. I see with a lot of competitive systems, with a lot of customers, that they still do that visually. So they open up in their acquisition software the GPS speed, and then they visually estimate, okay, the driver drove around 30 or 50 kilometers per hour. No? So how do we do that in test lab? Again, I switch back to the test lab software. So I have here, I go to the processing and process part in my software. I take my raw data and I'm gonna select my Belgian block and sawtooth runs, yeah, like that. And I'm gonna put them in a so-called input basket. So that's a container in which I put all the data that I would like to process. Then I go to the test lab, to the process view. Sorry for that. I've already prepared a process up front, which you see here on the left. In the next session on Friday, I will elaborate a little bit more on how to create a process. But as you can see here, the way to create a process in Test Lab Neo is just by adding simple blocks. You just add a block and on the right, you can fill out parameters. In this specific process, the main part is this part where I actually cut my measurement data based on the start and the end of the track. And here, this part where I actually check if the speed is within the limits, yes or no. This method here, the GPS split method. So how do I split my data? Maybe a first explanation. So once I open my data, you will actually see that I started to measure the data a little bit, a couple of meters before the start of the track, and I stopped my measurements a couple of meters after the end of the track. So those are parts which I would like to exclude from the actual speed check. So how do I define the start and the end of the track? Is by creating a track definition, and that's located under locations. So that's a KML file, that's a generic format which can be opened with a program, for example, like Google Earth, which I will quickly show you. It's opening on the left of my screen. There you go. So it zooms in onto the location of the proving ground. As said, it was somewhere in Germany. So here you have my proving ground, and the durability tracks were actually here. Yeah? So when I zoom in a little bit more, so the start and the end of the track I define by just drawing these two lines. Yeah? So here is the start of the track. I started my measurements a couple of meters before and a couple of meters after the end of the track. So it's the only thing that I needed to do. That's a one-time operation. It's saved in the KML file, which I can use in my Tesla software. The actual checks are done in these blocks over here. Also here, the checks is done in a very comprehensive way. So you don't need to know any programming language. It's written in a very, let's say, spoken way. So I do two checks. So first I check my GPS speed and I calculate if the mean speed is between 25 and 35 kilometers per hour. Yeah. And the next part is where I check if the duration of my speed is at least 90% of the time. So that's an extra check that I would like to do to see if the driver at least drove 90% of the time between 25 and 35 kilometers per hour. Good. And the same for the runs done at 50 kilometers per hour, but here I check between 45 and 55 kilometers per hour. If the method sees that the run does not comply to these two checks, it will add a suffix to the run name called underscore bad 50 and underscore bad 30 for the 30 runs. So that's how I can visualize if there is a run not okay or okay. Good. Good. I'm gonna run the process. I'm gonna switch back to the data. Go to the test procedure check. So this run or this process takes a little bit less as 1 minute. I've selected the folder in which you will save the different processed runs. Almost there. Yeah, so now they're coming in. So I had selected 8 runs, and you will see out of the 8 runs, there are a couple more seconds. There are 4 runs marked as bad. Yeah. So from the 8, according to the process which I've created, 4, there is a potential speed which is outside of the predefined checks. Now, I could simply accept this, or I can do a visual check. I first would like to do a visual check. And in this case, I'm not going to use the pivot table and the preview picture, but I'm going to open up a dedicated view, which I've created. It's called test procedure check. And I'm going to drag the first run into that display. I'll enlarge it a little bit. You see two things here. At the top, you see the calculated mean speed, which is the value over here. And the bottom row is the actual speed duration. So here you see the mean speed is nicely between the 25 and 35 kilometers per hour. And also the speed duration is larger than 90%. At the bottom here, you see the speed, the GPS speed. The dotted lines is my min and max. And the red is actually the GPS speed, but cut based on the track definition. I can scroll to the next runs like that. I go to the first bad one. This is the first bad one. So here you see that the calculated mean speed is 46, which is still okay. It's between 45 and 55 kilometers per hour, but it's only for 68% of the time between those two limits. And this is most probably due to this first part over here. So like this, I can, as a test engineer, objectively, not just based on a visualization and subjectively estimate, okay, this is good or bad. No, this is really based pure on numbers. So this makes it very easy for the test engineer to decide these are good runs and these are bad runs. Good, let's go back to my presentation. Good, so that was actually an overview of the data acquisition system, how we can do the test setup, and how you can measure and validate data for a typical durability test campaign. Yeah. The last couple of slides, I do not have time to go too much into details, but I would just would like to give you an overview of the typical customers of us. So the first customer for durability, at least. So the first customer, and that's the big customer from us, is General Motors. And that's a customer which is a customer from us worldwide. So they have a lot of SCADAs systems from us, and also using Tesla extensively. One of their challenges before they switched to the SimCenter SCADAs hardware is their ever-growing and challenging volume of testing that they had. So they were looking for more and more testing systems. And also they were looking for ways to improve the efficiency, the way that they did their measurement campaigns. And that's the reason why they switched from a competitive systems to the SimCenter SCADAs data acquisition system. And this efficiency is something that that they appreciate very much. If you look at the quote here at the bottom, so since the SimCenter SCADAs data acquisition system is streamlined for efficiency, it lets engineering teams to do their jobs much more quickly and more easily. So this is an automotive OEM customer from us. We also have a lot of automotive supplier customers. This is Faurecia. Faurecia is from origin a French company, but it's also now a multinational company. And this specific customer is located in the, also in the US. Faurecia makes, amongst other things, exhaust systems. They also make seats, but in this particular case, it was the company who makes the exhaust systems. So this specific customer was looking for ways to improve the product quality and also the durability of their products. If they compare their systems to competitive systems, they were lacking lacking a little bit behind. So that's why we're looking for systems to improve that quality. And also they were looking for ways to streamline their testing and measurement campaigns. Also here, the quote at the bottom. So we are very happy to say that we can effortlessly achieve this streamlining with the combination of SCADAs Recorder and SimCenter Tesla. And then the last customer, which I would like to indicate, is a customer from the transportation industry. So Daimler Trucks. Also, Daimler is a very good customer from us, and not only for the products that we sell, but also for our engineering service that we deliver. So here in this particular case, our engineering services department helped them in doing customer correlation projects in several markets in which they sell their products. And also they help them to improve the measurement instrumentation and the execution of the data collection. So if you look at the quote here, he confirmed that, yeah, that they were very happy that besides the actual product that we deliver, that they can help us, provide us with the full line of services. If you would like to have more information on one of those customers or other customers, don't hesitate to contact our local representative. So Kumar, who is also in the webinar over here, he will be very happy to give you some more information on these customers. Good. And with that, just in time, we come to the end of this session. Small recap for the session on Friday. So there, I will extend a little bit more on the load and fatigue analysis. There will be two parts, one on the analysis, where I first give a little bit more theory on what is an SN curve, what is a rain flow, and much more. And also the part where I show you how, with our solution, you can create a very nice report and share the data with other teams. And with that, we come to the Q&A part. I've seen that quite some questions coming in the chat.
Yes, Kurt. We've got quite a few questions. So Kumar, if you can switch on your camera as well, Kurt. Let's get to the Q&A session without any delay. The first question is from Ravi Kumar Shinde. He wants to know, can we increase storage capacity?
For the SCADA's recorder, there we have a removable storage. So the compact flash card, the maximum storage that we offer here is 256 gigabytes. On the SCADA's RS, that's a fixed SSD memory. So that we cannot change, but as you all know, the size and the capacity of these memory cards, also the SSD, they rapidly, almost exponentially increase over time. So there is a big chance that in the near future for the SCADA's RS that we will offer a bigger storage. Now, to be very honest, based on my experience, 200 or even more than 200 gigabytes, specifically for durability testing, is more than enough. If you do a one-day measurement, you talk about a couple of gigabytes. I hardly seen any cases where you have more than 10 or 20 gigabytes. So, but of course, I can imagine that you would like to save data from several days. So there, the 200 gigabytes is more than enough.
Okay, we move on to the next one from Suresh Kumar Gurusami. He wants to know, in the distributed setup, sensor locations might have higher vibration. Is it okay to place the DAQ near the sensor?
So the sensor has higher vibrations on that specific location, you say?
In the distributed setup, yes. Sensor locations might have higher vibration.
Yeah.
So is it okay to place the DAQ near the sensor? That's his question.
Well, the sensor location actually does not change. If you now use a centralized or distributed setup, the only difference is the location of your data acquisition setup. Yeah, I can imagine, I also briefly indicated that during my explanation, if you would have, let's say, smaller vehicles, let's say a small excavator, where potentially, I say potentially, that the weight of, especially if you use more SCADA's RS units, that would cause more vibrations. But in that case, yeah, if you talk about smaller vehicles, then you can question yourself, do I use a distributed setup or a centralized setup? But normally the location of the sensor did not change between centralized or distributed setup.
Okay, good. Suresh has a follow-up question. He wants to know if it's possible to connect to the acquisition system using IP address. How can we protect data access while doing